Ngowi TV, informed economies and business perspective.
You mentioned the importance of predictability and that it may not matter if taxes are too high. I think we need both. I think we need predictability and the taxes being reasonable. We don't want them too low, but also if they're too high, you will not have projects going ahead. I fully subscribe to your observation about TRA. Yes, they're a humble implementer, but they are also an advisor. And you know, we go through this process every year where we put submissions to the task force. And my experience from that process is a lot more weight is given to submissions that come from TRA rather than from the business sector. And so I think it's incumbent on TRA to take responsibility where they see dysfunction within the system to actually make recommendations that will help business. So that's just an observation there. And then lastly, you know, I think your point on having realistic budgets is really important, because at the end of the day we can rationalize the tax system as much as we want, but if the budgets are set too high, that will then inform behaviors. And you know, I'm aware from practical experience, not direct coming to me, but indirect when clients are speaking to me, where they've had discussions with TRA on certain issues, and maybe the TRA officers actually finally agreed with the taxpayer, look, your position's reasonable, but I have to deliver this much this month, and therefore, please, you have to agree to at least a proportion of this adjustment to help me reach my target. So I think your point on realistic budgets is very well placed. Thank you.
My name is Mithasia. I have only a quick question where the presenter spoke about our tax rate is low compared to other places. I saw the number like 13.something%, but I'm used to see in VAT we have 18, we have corporate tax around 30. I don't know how that number was arrived. Thank you.
CPA Sandra Chogo from the National Audit Office. My question is, the world is now moving from the traditional economy to the digital economy. My question is, how is Tanzania ready for that? Because I've been reading a lot about shared economy, so I'm worried about Tanzania. Where are we?
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. My name is Nicolaus Duhia from Tax Planning Associates Limited and TPA Auditors Arusha. Professor Ngowi always reminds me of Professor J.L. Hanson in my A-level economics some years ago. We were taught in those days that national debt is a burden on the posterity, and it is rightly so. Mine is just a comment, not a question. I wish the government could be transparent on the question of national debt. I share with the Professor Ngowi's concern that much as the debt is sustainable, the rate of growth is a bit alarming. What is important, for example, is for the government to tell the citizens that this year we paid so much of the national debt for the money which Mwalimu Nyerere borrowed 50 years ago to build Tazara. And this year, we paid so much for the money which the government borrowed 10 years ago from PPF and SSF to build UDOM. That way, people will appreciate that the borrowing is necessary and is useful for the economic development of the country. Likewise, for my colleagues in TRA, I remember Richard, we were in Arusha, I think, some years back, And we are telling them, do what like your colleagues in Kenya are doing, KRA. Every year, at the end of the year, they draw up some statistics. They say, out of the 18 trillion we collected this year, so much was spent to buy Dreamliner, Bombardiers. It tells the citizens that actually the money they are paying is used properly. And it also kind of encourages people to pay taxes because they know the taxes are going to the right places. Thank you.
Yes, sir. I have watched exactly the same. And, you know, if you remember, well, Matthew, you know, in the proposed constitution, forget about the process, but then I gave my written comment because there was this chapter, or rather, a provision on national debt, you know, that when it should be a constitutional issue, when are you going to borrow, how are you going to borrow, for what purpose, and then when we are going to repay, exactly issues that you raised, pay for what, you know, those kind of stuff. And I was some 2 years ago, I think I was somewhere in Namtumbo, and I took a photo, and some of you guys, we are in quite a number of groups, and it's a road from Namtumbo, and it's written, built from the people of America, you know? And I said, I gave a comment, it's time now we kind of fought our roads, say, built by Tanzania's taxpayers' money, you know, those kind of stuff. So that people really can see, yes, this is the tax money and that's how it has been used. So others really have been very good in advertising how they're using their tax money. Actually, sometimes they spend almost more than the money that they donated to market the infrastructure that they use, you know. A convoy that's costing $1 million to go and inaugurate infrastructure that costs less than $1 million, put it that way. So I think it's time again, I would agree, that we really show value for money that you have been collecting. And this was a comment, so I won't go into much detail. Sandra, I think from traditional to digital economy, how is Tanzania prepared, I think it could be a question of discussion here. But again, it's I understand this issue because, for example, when you go to e-commerce, for example, you know, e-commerce is really increasing, and specifically in the tourism sector, I understand it has been an issue how to capture, you know, the tax revenues that have been paid by international tourists, somebody making reservation in the US and then coming here, everything is paid. I think that's an issue. So I think it's time again we strengthen our e-commerce, but I understand through some of the infrastructure that are in place, they are supposed to be able to capture those kind of stuff. And this has been my debate in most of debates on infrastructure, because we have tended to talk mainly hard infrastructure, you know, roads, ports, airports, and we have forgotten soft infrastructure. Because it's soft infrastructure in terms of internet, you know, those kind of stuff. But I understand, maybe Richard will tell me later, there have been some infrastructure that will try to capture online transactions as much as possible. Now, it's really so much of my area, it's not so much my area of expertise, but I think some colleagues will say more. Now on the tax rate, my friend, I think I should have made myself clear, this is to use a diplomatic way, or to go directly.
Yeah, exactly, I think it was taken out of context. You know, the 13.7% that I'm saying is the tax to GDP ratio. Tax to GDP ratio, which is lower than Sub-Saharan Africa average, which is around 18%, you know. It's not VAT, it's not, corporate income tax. Because I understand corporate income tax is, yes, 30%, VAT, it's 18%. And of course, this 18% came only 2008. Before, it was 20%, you know, due to the global financial economic crisis as part of policy measures to fight the economic crisis. It went down. But I understand really, in the private sector, I think this time around, if I get it correct, I'm not sure whether PPSF are here, they had proposed the VAT to be around 16%, you know, those kind of stuff. So it's the 13% is not VAT, it's not corporate income tax, it is tax to GDP ratio. And this is supposed, you know, the higher the better, you know, the higher the better for the economy. In Sub-Saharan Africa, it's around 80%. In OECD, in that Organization for Economic Development, many developing countries is around 30-35%, you know. So you see, for advanced countries, tax to GDP ratio is higher. So the principle is the higher the better. Ours is low, so it's not good. So to make it clear. Now, my friend David, I'm almost some comments really, and some may respond in my comments in my column as you as in citizen. But on a serious note, I think. Thank you. The question of discrepancies in the number, the GDP number. You know, where, for example, you see the World Bank IMF are giving various numbers. I don't know really, because I've read GDP of 6.5%, 6.8%. Ours has been 7.2%, and it's not abnormal. I've seen these differences elsewhere. Because this is the question of forecasting, it depends really on the methodology that one is using, it depends on the data set that one is using, etc. But again, to call a spade, sometimes, of course, I'm not sure, but then from a theoretical point of view, there may be also some political numbers. And I want to go into that. The other thing is, of course, now for you as a decision maker, is really to try to read between lines and see is 7.2% realistic or not. You know that, because that's on the high side, you know. Now, really, for me, in order to understand whether the economy can expand by 7.2%, I'll look at the fundamentals. You know, I'll look at the fundamentals. I'll look at the growth, at the what I call the drivers of growth. For example, I'll look at the mining sector. And I say, you know, looking at what is or has been going around in the mining sector, and this has been one of the growth centers, are we really going to see the economy growing so much with all the policy, legal, regulatory framework reforms in the mining sector, where, in my view, the dust is not yet settled. So you can see I'm also thinking maybe it will be a little bit, if you go really realistically, maybe less than 7.2%. Looking at the construction, you know, construction has been booming, but I understand now it has slowed down. I talked to friends in the banking sector, they're a little bit cautious in lending to the real estate. And that's why they say we have burnt our fingers. So we may not really see the construction sector booming as it used to. You know, those kind of stuff. Agriculture, of course, depends a lot on the mercy of God. It depends on weather, you know. If there is good rain, etc., it may go well. So the question is, we have to talk to the weatherman. Are we really going to have this bumper harvest that will bring, you know, those kind of stuff. So I agree with you, David, that the number, the figure is debatable. But then this is forecasting. Some of you, Alex, I've mentioned Alex several times, sometimes maybe I'll tell you to stand so that they say, who is this Alex? You know, in forecasting, really, forecasting is just forecasting. We have normally error margin, you know, you say plus, minus, certain percent, you know. So the error margin, you know, may be tolerable, you know, those kind of stuff. The other thing that David came with is the question of national debt. I think you have said it all almost, but then I think your view was, the question of, foreign debt. And of course, I should have added more voice in here. When it comes to foreign debt, there are issues. Because this foreign debt is normally USD denominated. It's denominated in dollar, but then when it comes to its repayment, you repay it as a shilling. So what happens with the volatility of foreign currency is, even without borrowing more, really, you may have a bigger debt. Why? If the shilling depreciates, and then you are repaying your national debt using Tanzanian shillings, just by depreciation of the shilling, really, you may need to, to repay more debt. So maybe I should have said this in foreign debt. But then I think your question was, if our exports are dwindling, it means again our export earnings to support now the national debt, it can be an issue, and I'd agree with you. And again, of course, maybe in that line I should also have talked a little bit about domestic borrowing, because in this year's budget we are going to borrow more domestically than foreign, if I got the figures correct. And what are the issues? The issues are dangers, and that is the word, are dangers of crowding out the private sector. Because when the government is borrowing in domestic money market, where also the private sector is borrowing, what tends to be the issue is the private sector, the lenders who are, some of you maybe are here, banks or financial institutions, tend to listen to this client who has both the economic and political muscles than the private sector. And remember, we want this private sector to be the engine of the growth, you know. So if you crowd out the private sector, if credit private sector goes down because more credit has gone to the government, again it won't be good for the economy. So this is just really cautionary. I'm not saying this is how it's going to be, but then it's good to give this caution so that really we also reduce domestic borrowing. But again, the fundamentals will be, you know, if you have to reduce domestic borrowing, you have the alternative, of course, is to increase external borrowing. Now the question is our house in order, is it clean enough to access external borrowing. External borrowing is, you know, it's expensive. And it has got issues of, you know, exaggerated variations. The other thing from David again, and I'll skip some of the details, oil prices have tended to go a little bit high, you know, that kind of stuff. Formalization, I think I won't go so much into detail, but then I would agree, and as I said earlier, presumptive taxation, I think, really should be an issue. And we have colleagues, and Richard, you know, Professor Ord, what if you study, we have been doing some studies, they call it taxation, institution, and participation. We meet in Tanzania, Mozambique, and Tanzania, Angola, and Zambia. And part of issues have been, you know, maybe it's more wiser to tax the informal sector amidst informality through presumptive taxation. And I understand that there are issues. So let's fix what is broken within that. We are likely to get more money from here because we know, and you guys know, even some of you, maybe you have some of your activities in the external, in the informal sector, and you may be making more money than in the formal sector. Now, if you bring them into the tax net, you know, we may get more money going to the national coffers, but also it will reduce also the burden on the tax. You know, some friends have done studies, again, Lucas Katera at Repoa, I think all studies have shown, you know, that the willingness and ability to pay taxes is a function of a number of issues, including tax rates. So the lower the tax rate, really, the higher the voluntary compliance, you know, those kind of stuff. But then how do you arrive at that? If all of us would come into the tax net to pay, I think we did a study sometimes, I can't remember, 2013, 2015, twice, called the, you know, $1 billion question. We estimated how many people are really paying money. Tax, it's less than 20%, you know. What's the implication? The implication is exactly what I said. When I'm paying my money, my tax, I have to pay my tax, but they are also to shoulder the burden of this one who is not paying. Because there's public goods and services. They are consuming them anyway. And of course, we have debate whether the informal sector should pay tax or not. Indeed, it is a wrong economy, which should suggest that any section of the society should not pay tax. Everybody should pay tax. Because what is the issue? Yes, you are the informal sector. You are not paying taxes. But you are using our roads. You are using our public school. And indeed, to put it, to call it a spade a spade, when it comes to education, to health, I think most of those in the informal sector, actually, they are the ones who are using more public health than the education system, to put it that way.